لا تراه العيون بمشاهدة العيان ولكن تدركه القلوب بحقائق الإيمان معروف بالدلالة.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله وكفى والسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى. اللهم أخرجنا من ظلمات الوهم وأكرمنا بنور الفهم. اللهم افتح علينا أبواب رحمتك وانشر علينا خزائن علومك برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. وصلي على محمد وآله الطاهرين. Inshallah, as in past sessions, I'm going to start with some of the short sayings from the third section of NAHJ UL-BALAGHA. We've reached number 43 of the short sayings. It reads in Arabic, وَقَالَ عَلَيْهِ السَّلَامِ فِي ذِكْرِ خَبَّابِ بْنِ الْأَرَتِ رحم الله خباب بن الأرت فلقد أسلم راغبا وهاجر طائعا وقنع بالكفاف ورضي عن الله وعاش مجاهدا. The translation goes like this. Imam Ali alayhi salam said, while extolling Khabbab ibn al-Arat, he said, may God have mercy on Khabbab ibn al-Arat, for he accepted Islam eagerly and emigrated willingly. He was content with mere subsistence, and was pleased with God, and lived fighting for God. One note I wanted to mention before I get into this hadith, you probably will notice sometimes if you're looking at a published text of NAHJ UL-BALAGHA, if you compare the Arabic that you have in front of you to the Arabic that I'm reading, you might sometimes see discrepancies between the two texts. If you do, that's not a problem, and that's something that's very usual. One of the realities that we face with NAHJ UL-BALAGHA, as with many of our hadith texts, is that we have different copies and different editions, and each of these editions has some discrepancies in it. So for instance, one of the discrepancies that you find amongst the five major editions of NAHJ UL-BALAGHA that we have now is that the numbering is a little bit off, right? So generally in the Hawza or in text, we use as a standard for NAHJ UL-BALAGHA the copy of what's called Subhi Saleh. So he was the name of one of the commentators of NAHJ UL-BALAGHA. So his copy is kind of used as a standard. But you'll find Ibn Abdul Hadid, for instance, or some of the other, like Ibn Maytham, they have different numbering systems. And so in the beginning, you'll start off together. But then, for instance, maybe they'll take a couple of short sayings and put them together and count them as one, whereas in another copy, they're separated as separate numbers. All right. So sometimes I might say 43 for this one, but in your copy, it might be 42 or 44. Right, so you have to kind of keep that in mind and don't be thrown off and think that, oh, one's wrong and the other one's right or something like that. That's just the reality of what we have to deal with NAHJ UL-BALAGHA. Also, some of the words sometimes are different. For instance, in this hadith, just one very minor difference. The copy that you probably have in front of you says, Yarhamullahu Khabbab ibn al-Arat. So it starts with Yarham, whereas I read Rahima. Right, it's just the difference of a past tense and a present tense verb. Sometimes there's a reason why I've chosen one over the other. I've always chosen one based on commentaries. It's not like I've just made up something myself. So it's based on commentaries and based on the text and the versions of the text that are available for us. Right, so just keep that in mind. Don't be thrown off if you see some discrepancies like that in the texts. This hadith is about a personality that who's unfortunately very seldom mentioned. Even personally, I never even heard of Khabbab ibn al-Arat before I read this hadith. And then when I read the hadith and I was trying to understand who Khabbab is, I looked in biographies of companions of the Prophet and I found his name. He was a companion from the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he, according to his biography, he was the sixth person to ever accept Islam. Right? So he's way up there amongst the sabiqun, right? As-sabiqun. He was an outstanding companion of the Prophet and also of Imam Ali alayhi salam. He was one of the people who was tortured right in the very beginning. We usually know of Bilal and Ammar and the parents of Ammar and these sorts of people who are famous now in our own culture. But Khabbab was also there. He was being tortured. In fact, the stories, the history of his life says that he was scorched. They took his either they put him on burning sand or they turned him on his stomach and on his back they put burning coals and things like that. So they burnt his back to try to get him to renounce Islam and go back to shirk. So he bore these scars until the end of his life, and he was, it was almost like a badge of courage that he carried with him. So this was Khabbab. He was an outstanding person, a companion of the Prophet and Imam Ali alayhi salam. This hadith, the setting for the hadith itself is at the time when Imam Ali alayhi salam was returning from Siffin. Right, so he had left the city of Kufa, where his government was, his capital was. He had gone off to fight Siffin in near Damascus. On his way back, when he came, when he entered Kufa along with his army, he saw that there's a new kind of these newly dug graves in a place that he had never seen them before. And so he asks some people who were around there in Kufa. He said, "What are these graves here? I've never seen them before." So he tells, the person answers him and tells him that Khabbab has passed away. Like, while you were gone, he was an old man at the time, so he hadn't gone for the battle. He had stayed back in Kufa and he passed away while the Imam was away. So Khabbab, when he died, he asked that he be buried in a certain part of, on the outskirts of Kufa. Right? And this was a new precedent set, because until that time, the history books say, until that time, everybody used to just be buried in their own yards. Right, in their own household, they would be buried right there. So there was no such thing as a public graveyard for all the people in Kufa. Right? So Khabbab set the precedent for the graveyard. Right? He asked that he be buried in a particular place. And since that time, until the time that Imam Ali got there, six or seven more people had died as well. So all of them also were buried right next to Khabbab. Right? So when the Imam comes, he sees that there are these seven graves newly dug in a new place that he's never seen them before. So he asks them, they tell him it's Khabbab, and when he hears that and he feels so sad for having lost such a good friend, he says this hadith. All right, so he mentions a couple of traits of Khabbab for which he extols him, for which he praises him. Another thing about Khabbab, his name is Al-Arat. Arat, in Arabic, it means that he had some sort of a speech impediment. Right, so the biographies say that he was a slave originally. He was bought by one of the Arabs, and the lady who owned him freed him. But he had this problem of either he stuttered or he had some sort of a speech impediment, and for that reason he was called Arat. Okay, so the hadith itself, Imam Ali says, may God have mercy on Khabbab. For a couple of reasons, he says. One thing, he accepted Islam eagerly. All right, so this is probably a reference to the fact that he was one of the first to accept. He was a slave, he was one of the lower classes, so he had no ulterior motives in accepting Islam. Right? He accepted it because he saw the truth in it, and he withstood the torture that he received from the Quraysh and kept his faith despite all that. And he emigrated willingly. Right? He was one of the people who came to Medina right with the Prophet ﷺ. He was content with mere subsistence. Right? Not only did he have a poor beginning, but he continued to live very poorly as well. Right, so he had no luxury at all, and lived, and he was content with living as a simple person. So this is also something that the Imam praises him for. The next thing he says, and he was pleased with God, and he lived fighting for God. Another thing that they say about him, that this is an allusion to, is that he was there with the Prophet at every battle that the Prophet fought. Right, so under no circumstances did he fail to show up at a battle alongside the Prophet. Right, so these are some of the qualities of this person named Khabbab ibn al-Arat, a person that has unfortunately gone down, not been mentioned in history very much, but the Imam, he mentions him and gets him into history by putting him in Nahj al-Balagha. The next hadith is number 44, and when you look at the content of this along with number 43, you see that they're both the same hadith. This is basically just a continuation of the same hadith. Some copies of Nahj al-Balagha have split it up as 43 and 44. Other copies have put it as one. But in any case, they both fit together. This is a continuation of the same hadith about Khabbab. وَقَالَ عَلَيْهِ السَّلَامُ طُوبَ لِمَنْ ذَكَرَ الْمَعَادِ وَعَمِلَ لِلْحِسَابِ وَقَنِعَ بِالْكَفَافِ وَرَضِيَ عَنِ اللَّهِ. The Imam says, glad tidings to him who remembers resurrection and works for the final accounting, who contents himself with mere subsistence and is pleased with God. So very clearly you see some of these qualities that he mentions here and that he kind of extols in general are the same things that he mentioned for Khabbab. So you can picture he's praying for Khabbab particularly first, and he says Khabbab was like this, and he mentions five or six different attributes of Khabbab. And then he turns in general and says, anybody who has these sorts of attributes, may Allah have mercy on them. I give glad tidings to them, right? Glad tidings for paradise. So these qualities, the first of these is that the person remembers resurrection, right? So he praises any person who can constantly maintain a remembrance of the Day of Judgment, right? Not to live and be heedless of what's to come, but rather live every instant with a constant awareness of the resurrection and the fact that Allah is going to ask you for everything that you've done, everything that you spent, everything that you've spoken, and so on. The second quality he praises and gives glad tidings for is that a person works for the final accounting. Right? So not only does the person remember on a constant basis that he's going to be put in front of Allah, but he also works constantly for that. So his goals and everything he does, and work doesn't necessarily mean working for a livelihood, but whatever he does, whether it's working for a livelihood or studying or playing or whatever it might be, that his actions are constantly with the goal of the judgment in mind. Right? So he wants to do things that are beneficial for his judgment and stay away from things that are either useless or harmful for his judgment. The third quality he extols is that the person is content with, he contents himself with mere subsistence. Right? Kafaf in Arabic, it means the bare minimum you need to survive. Right? Kafaf, sometimes you see that it means the absolute bare minimum, like just enough to keep you from dying. Right? That's not necessarily the only usage of the word. In a hadith, we see that kafaf is also used for what a person needs, right? Needs, not wants. Right? So if you consider what you need, it's not quite as you don't have to live quite as ascetic a life as living just to survive, right? You can have more than that, but it's basically your needs, right? Your kind of reasonable needs, enough money to do what you need to do to support your family, to have the enjoyment and everything that you need, but not luxury, right? So that's kafaf definitely excludes luxury, but it's not necessarily as little as simply surviving. But a person who can content himself with that, he's in good shape for the akhirah, inshallah. The last quality he mentions is that the person is pleased with God, right? Radiyallahu anhum wa radu an. Alright, the next hadith is number 45. It reads like this: وَقَالَ عَلَيْهِ السَّلَامُ لَوْ ضَرَبْتُ خَيْشُومَ الْمُؤْمِنِ بِسَيْفِ هَذَا عَلَىٰ أَنْ يُبْغِضَنِي مَا أَبْغَضَنِي وَلَوْ صَبَبْتُ الدُّنْيَا بِجُمَّاتِهَا عَلَىٰ الْمُنَافِقِ عَلَىٰ أَنْ يُحِبَّنِي مَا أَحَبَّنِي وَذَلِكَ أَنَّهُ قُضِيَ فَانْقَضَى عَلَى لِسَانِ النَّبِيِّ الْأُمِّي صلى الله عليه وآله أَنَّهُ قَالَ يَا عَلِي لَا يُبْغِضُكَ مُؤْمِنُ وَلَا يُحِبُّكَ مُنَافِقٌ. The translation of this hadith goes like this. He says, if I were to strike a believer's nose with this sword of mine, so that he would hate me, he would not hate me. And if I were to pour all of the blessings of this world on a hypocrite, so that he would love me, he would not love me. This is because it has been decreed in the words of the unlettered prophet, where he said, O Ali, no believer will ever hate you, and no hypocrite will ever love you. This hadith speaks about the love of Ali alayhi salam, or the absence thereof. And it says that if somebody has this love for him, if they understand who he is and they have a heartfelt attachment to him, then nothing can divert them from that attachment to him. And vice versa, anyone who doesn't have that and who has ulterior motives and for whatever reason has a grudge against him, then nothing's ever going to bring them to love him. Right? So the way he expresses this is kind of by bringing the most gruesome and most difficult sort of symbolism, and saying, if I were to take the sword of mine and strike a believer's nose, right, chop a believer's nose off, right, so that he would hate me, then he would never hate me. He would continue to love me just as he loved me before I did that. And the opposite, if I were to take all the blessings, everything you can possibly think of, all the wealth, every blessing you can think of, and hand it over to a hypocrite, right, someone who doesn't have that love for me, and try to buy his love for me, I would never be able to do so. Right? He would continue to hate me as long as he lived, despite the blessings I would give him. There's a story that goes with this that illustrates the same idea in real life. There's one hadith where a man he passes by an Ethiopian slave, a Habashi, he says, and he sees that he's going to get some water from a well or something like that, And when he pays attention to the person, he sees that he's missing his hand, right? His hand's not there. And so he says, "Who did this to you? What happened? Tell me the story of how you lost your hand." So the slave, he mentions, he says, "The person who took my hand, he's the best of all people." And so the guy, he's more intrigued by this, and he says, "Tell me the story, who is this person?" So then the man tells him. He says, "I was part of a band of robbers, right? We were about, I think he says about 7 or 8 people. And we had, we used to pillage caravans and these sorts of things. And so one time we were caught, we were brought before Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib. And he asked us what we had done, and we admitted our guilt to having stolen all these different things. So the Imam, he asked us first, "Didn't you know that this was haram? Like, why did you do such a thing?" And we explained that we did know it was haram, but we did it anyway. So he commanded, he ordered that our hands be cut off, right, as the punishment for stealing. When he did this, he commanded that the 4 fingers be cut off from here up. The thumb be left and the hand be left. That's how the Sharia says. When it says to cut off the hands of a burglar, it means the 4 fingers here, not the rest of the hand. So the Imam, he cut off, he had the 4 fingers cut off from each of us. And then after that was done, he commanded the people who were taking care of us to wrap our hands up carefully so that they would heal properly, that we'd be as comfortable as possible. And then he put us in a special house to recover and let us stay there as long as we needed to. And he fed us the best things. The things he mentions are some sort of a clarified oil or butter and honey. I mean, it may not sound that appetizing, but probably it was something that was very rich and very delicious for them. So he made sure that we had good food, that we were comfortable, until our hands had healed. Then he sent us on away, but before sending us, he made sure that we had the best clothes possible, and then he sent us off. And he told us that if you repent for what you've done, for the sin that you've committed, then inshallah Allah will join you together with your hands in heaven, right? So he told us that we have to repent, and if we do so, Allah will forgive us and we'll end up in paradise with our hands intact. And he says, if you don't, if you fail to repent, then he'll still give you your hands back, but it'll be at hellfire, right? So this Habashi, this Ethiopian slave who had been a robber, he realized who Ali was, and he saw how great he was as a ruler and how just he had been and how kind he had been despite the fact that he was just, and that had made him love him, and despite even the fact that he chopped off his hands and all this and probably changed his life significantly, had no effect on his love for him. A similar hadith on the other side, during the time after Imam Ali was struck down by Ibn Muljim, he faces Ibn Muljim at one point and he asks him, Have I not done everything for you? Right? I've given you whatever I could. I've done so much for you. Why did you do this?" And so Ibn Muljim, he responds like this. His sentence goes like this. He says, "Shadahtuhu 40 sabahan wa sa'altu Allah an yaqtula bihi sharra khalqi." So Ibn Muljim, he has a sword and he says, "I sharpened it for 40 days. And I put poison on it, sorry, for 40 days, and I asked Allah to kill the worst of his creatures with the sword." So Imam Ali says, "La araka illa maqtulan bihi, wa la araka illa min sharri khalqi." So the Imam says, "Exactly, the worst of creatures will be killed with a sword, and that'll be you." And he orders that he be executed with the sword, with the same sword that he had poisoned for the worst of creatures. Right? Which shows that despite the fact that Imam had done a lot for Ibn Muljim, he still hated him, and he continued to hate him until he was killed. Inshallah, with that, I'll end this section of the discussion on Nahj al-Balagha, and we'll go back to the continuing discussion that we've had on the 31st letter of Nahj al-Balagha, which is a letter from Imam Ali alayhi salam to his son, Imam Hassan. In this section that we're going to read today, the Imam says the following. He says, "Was'a fi kadhik, wa la takun khazanan li ghayrik. وإذا أنت هديت لقصدك فكن أخشع ما تكون لربك واعلم أن أمامك طريقا ذا مسافة بعيدة ومشقة شديدة وأنه لا غنى بك فيه عن حسن الارتياد وقدر بلاغك من الزاد مع خفة الظهر فلا تحملن على ظهرك فوق طاقتك فيكون ثقل ذلك وبالا عليك وَإِذَا وَجَدْتَ مِنْ أَهْلِ الْفَاقَةِ مَنْ يَحْمِلُ لَكَ زَادَكَ إِلَى يَوْمِ الْقِيَامَةِ فَيُوَافِيكَ بِهِ غَدًا حَيْثُ تَحْتَاجُ إِلَيْهِ فَاغْتَنِمْهُ وَحَمِّلْهُ إِيَّاهُ وَأَكْثِرْ مِنْ تَزْوِيدِهِ وَأَنْتَ قَادِرٌ عَلَيْهِ فَلَعَلَّكَ تَطْلُبُهُ فَلَا تَجِدُهُ وَاغْتَنِمْ مَنْ اسْتَقْرَضَكَ فِي حَالِ غِنَاكَ لِيَجْعَلَ قَضَاءَهُ لَكَ فِي يَوْمِ أُسْرَتِكَ وَاعْلَمْ أَنَّ أَمَامَكَ عَقَبَةً كَأُودًا المخف فيها أحسن حالا من المثقل والمبطئ عليها أقبح حالا من المسرع وأن مهبطك بها لا محالة إما على جنة أو على نار فارتد لنفسك قبل نزولك ووطئ المنزل قبل حلولك فليس بعد الموت مستعتب ولا إلى الدنيا منصرف. The translation of the section goes like this. He says, endeavor in your struggle to earn a living, but do not simply store things for others. If you are led to your goal, then be as humble as ever to your Lord. Know that before you lies a path of great length, filled with intense hardship, and you have no choice but to seek your sustenance as best as you can, to procure enough provisions to get you to your destination. However, your back is weak, so do not load it with more than you can bear, lest its weight be a burden for you. If you find among the destitute one to carry your provisions to the day of resurrection and deliver it to you tomorrow when you need it, then take advantage of him and load them on him. In fact, load him with abundant supplies while you are able, for it could be that you later seek him to no avail. And take advantage of the one who seeks a loan from you while you have plenty, because he will repay the debt to you on your day of hardship. Also know that before you lies a treacherous pass. He who travels lightly on it is better off than he who travels heavily. He who passes slowly across it is worse off than he who passes it swiftly. And know that you must necessarily alight from it, either into a garden or a fire. So stock it with provisions before you arrive, and ready your destination before you alight. For after death, there is no second chance, and no way to return to this world. This section of the hadith is very beautiful, because he paints a couple of very nice images for us to help us to picture what he's talking about. In general, this section is speaking about he's trying to give us a positive attitude and a correct attitude towards earning a living and money and these sorts of issues of wealth. First of all, he emphasizes the idea that you have to work hard. Right, he doesn't want to encourage, when they encourage us towards asceticism and being kind of indifferent towards the temporal world, they never want us to go to the wrong extreme, any extreme really, but to the wrong extreme and say, okay, well, I don't really care about the world, I don't really care about money, therefore I'm not going to work, I'm not going to do anything. Right? They want to make sure we never fall into that trap and become lazy, become unproductive and that sort of thing. Right? So the first thing he tells his son and then tells us, is to endeavor in your struggle to earn a living. One interesting thing about the sentence is, he says, wasa fi kadhik. Just as a side note as well, here I've read wasa with a waw, and I've translated it accordingly with no kind of connection to what's before it. It's a waw istinafiya. In some of the copies of NAHJ UL-BALAGHA, it says fasa with a fa. Right? The difference between those two letters is that the fa indicates there's some connection between this sentence and what came before it. Therefore, or thus, or that sort of a thing. Right, but there is no connection, any obvious connection between this sentence and what came before, but rather this is a new sentence and it's tied to what comes after, right? So I've chosen the copy that says the wa wasa rather than fasa, right? That's a side note just for people who know Arabic and just to explain the difference in the two copies of NAHJ UL-BALAGHA. So one thing is he says wasa fi kadhik, right? So he mentions the word kadh. We have an ayah in the Quran in Surah Al-Infitar that says, "Ya ayyuhal insan, innaka kadihun ila rabbika kadhan famulaqi." In that ayah, in that verse of the Quran, Allah tells us that we as people, all people, are necessarily, of no choice of our own, are necessarily engaged in a life that's full of hardship, right? And it's leading us up towards God. That you're necessarily, just all people, whether you're Muslim or not Muslim, it doesn't make a difference. The reality of life is that you are engaged in this kadh. And kadh is like, it's mashaqqa, it's hardship. You're engaged in these constant toils and tribulations. And the final result is Allah. فَمُلَاقِي, then you finally meet with Allah. Okay, so life itself is kadh. Life is equivalent to hardship, to difficulty and these sorts of things. So here he's referred again to life as kadh. And he says, you have this kadh in front of you, this life full of toils and hardship, right? You're struggling to earn a living. Right, that's in parentheses I put earning a living because the whole thing is talking about the money that you earn and then how you spend it and how you don't spend it, whether you hoard it or whether you give it to people and that sort of a thing. All right, so in this life that's full of hardship and full of toils in which we are struggling to earn a living, he says, work hard. Right, have sa'i, work hard, intensify your struggle in this life which is already full of hardship. All right, so this is an indication not to be lazy and to make sure that we're working hard. But usually when we think about working hard, we also think about earning a lot of money, right? Work hard and earn a lot of money, make a good living, right? He skips even mentioning that. He doesn't mention how much money you're going to make and that sort of a thing, how comfortable you're going to be and that sort of a thing, because that's assumed that you know that our minds already go straight to that. What he sees as his duty to explain to us is, first of all, work hard. And then he says, but make sure that you don't end up storing your wealth for other people. Okay, don't simply be a treasurer who's storing up this wealth for other people. All right, so he doesn't even mention the fact that you're going to earn a lot of money because you're working hard. You're going to have a comfortable living and that sort of a thing. Right, that's assumed that we already know about that. We already are thinking about that. But he skips to the problem that you are definitely going to face, and that's that you're going to end up having a bunch of money and then maybe not knowing what to do with it. Right, and instead of using it on yourself or giving it to other people as charity, you're going to end up storing it and become miserly and end up kind of losing out on all the benefit you can have from this money. And there's an interesting hadith from the Prophet ﷺ where he says the following. He says, any money that you fail to give in charity or spend on yourself is the property of your heirs. Right, so it's an interesting way of thinking of it. All right, we usually think of the money, all the money that I possess is my money. I call it my money, whether I need it now or don't need it now. Whether I spend it on myself or don't spend it on myself. It's all my money because I've earned it. Right, it's in my bank account. But the Prophet says, no, that's not the case. The money, you might hold the money, it might be yours legally. Right, but it's not yours until you either spend it on yourself, that's when it becomes yours, or you give it as charity for the sake of Allah, then it becomes yours. Right? But before that, it doesn't belong to you. It belongs to your heirs. And the proof is that as soon as you die, then where does all that money go? The only money that benefits you once you die is the money that you spent for yourself, right, to make your own life and your family and that sort of thing. Or you spent it on charity for the sake of Allah. Anything else doesn't belong to you and it immediately passes on to your heirs. So he says, your money is what you spend for the sake of the hereafter. Right? That's your money, not the money that you keep or you store. In NAHJ UL-BALAGHA as well, we have a hadith from Imam Ali to the same effect. He says, O son of Adam, in whatever you earn over and above your subsistence, you are a treasurer for someone else. Right? So whatever you earn, if you're earning more than what you need or what you use, then you're earning not for yourself, but you're earning for other people, for your heirs. Right? So all the work that you're doing, you're never going to benefit from it because you're not spending it either on yourself or on charity, but you're simply earning for the sake of other people. Right, so it's a very nice way of thinking about this and putting in perspective how we earn things and what we do with the money that we earn. All right, so he says, do not simply store these things, meaning the money, the wealth, all the stuff for other people. Use it. Then he says, if you're led to your goal, then be as humble as ever to your Lord. All right, if you're led to your goal, here he's referring to monetary success. Right, you're working hard, you're trying to make money so that you can be self-sufficient. You don't have to turn to anyone else, that sort of thing. If you get to that stage, then thank God, right? The first thing you need to do is thank God for giving you the success to be able to have enough money to support yourself. Then he says, know that before you lies a path of great length filled with intense hardship, right? This path, he's referring here to the path of the dunya, the path of our life before death. Right, some of the commentators seem to apply this to the path from death to the Day of Judgment, right? The sirat and all the different hardships that we're going to face between the time that the resurrection happens to the time that we're actually there in front of Allah and He's judging us. Right, that's also a long path that we have to face. But here in this hadith, he's speaking about the long path that lies ahead of us in this life itself. Right? So it's a life that's filled with, it's long, right? We don't know how long, but it's long. And it's filled with intense hardship, which is life itself. And then he says, and you have no choice but to seek your sustenance as best as you can to procure enough provisions to get you to your destination. Right? So the reality of life is that you have to survive until you die. You have to make ends meet. You have to do whatever you can to provide yourself for the provisions that you have to have to survive until the time that you die. So you have no choice but to do that. Every human being has to do that unless he wants to give up his life. However, he says, your back is weak. Right? You have to, on one hand, you have no choice but to earn, to collect, to buy, to have all these things to get you through the dunya, to survive until you pass away. Right? On the other hand, you have a weak back. Right? A weak back meaning your ability to kind of carry all these things is very little. Right? So now imagine yourself on a trip, right? On a journey, especially a journey where you have to pull your own weight. Right? So you're walking from one city to another, or you're part of a caravan, these sorts of things. Right? So if you were traveling like that, then the lighter you travel, the better. It's true, you have to have enough food and all the clothing and all that stuff that you need in order to complete the trip successfully. That's one of the parameters you have to observe. But if you pack too much food, right, so much that even when you get there, you still have a lot left over. Or you have so many clothes that you don't even possibly need it. You have furniture, all sorts of things to carry with you. And how much can you carry? Your back is light, is weak. Your arms are weak. How far can you carry extra stuff? Right. So you have these two parameters. You want to make sure you have enough, but you want to also make sure you don't have too much. So he says, however, your back is weak. So do not load it with more than what you can bear. Right. Don't put more on your back than you can bear, lest its weight be a burden for you. All right. Now, how do we lessen our burden? Right? He tells us a couple of ways to lessen our burden so that we can get to our destination successfully and have enough at the destination to live successfully and live happily, but at the same time, not have to carry ourselves all the way there. Right? So if you're on, go back to our analogy, if you're traveling like that from point A to point B and you don't have the strength to carry your stuff by yourself, then what are you going to do? You're going to hire somebody else to carry it for you. Get a car that can carry it for you, whatever, like some sort of means that you can put your luggage on, and then that'll take it for you and deliver it at the doorstep when you get to your destination. So you yourself don't have to carry it. Okay. So he says the way to do that is to find somebody who can carry your burden for you. If you find, he says, among the destitute, one to carry your provisions to the day of resurrection and deliver it to you tomorrow when you need it, then take advantage of him and load them on him. Okay, so the kind of person you're looking for to carry your things, and we're not talking about worldly possessions anymore. They somehow is going to carry your furniture for you and deliver it to you on the Day of Judgment. That's not what you need there. Right? But what you need is, you need this money itself. Not the money, but you need the reward that the money can buy you. Right? So he says that if you have excess baggage right now, you don't know what to do with it. Instead of carrying it yourself and never benefiting from it, benefiting from it at all, find someone who's poor, right, and get him to help you carry this burden all the way to the Day of Judgment. Right, so give him a loan, give him charity, let him have whatever you don't need. Right, help him get him on his feet. He'll carry that burden for you, so you don't have to deal with it when you pass through life and to death and to the afterlife. But on the Day of Judgment, when you need it the most, when you're poor, then he'll come back and he'll repay the loan at that time, and he'll have delivered that all that luggage to you successfully. Then he says, that's not enough, right? Don't just give a little bit of excess to one or two poor people, right? He says, rather, in fact, load him with abundant supplies while you are able, right? So find as many people as you can, as many poor people as you can, and anything you don't need for yourself, for your family, for the people, for the expenses that are required of you, then get these people to help you carry that burden all the way to the Day of Judgment. Right? So do it as much as you can, find as many people, and give them abundant supplies, meaning give them a lot of charity and really kind of load them up, and they'll deliver it to you on that side, on the other end. He says, do this, right? Do it as much as you can while you are able, for it could be that you later seek him out to no avail. Right? So two things could happen. Right? He mentions one of them here, but two things could happen. Right now, I might have the money to be able to load these people up, right? Give the poor charity so they can deliver it to me on that side. What about tomorrow? There's no guarantee that money's going to be with me. But regardless of whether tomorrow I have the money or not, I'm still going to be poor on that end. Right? So why not insure yourself now when you have the excess money? Hand over the money to these people and set it on its way. Right? That's going to meet you on the other end anyway. But if you wait until tomorrow and then expect that tomorrow you'll be able to load them up, maybe tomorrow you won't have the same money. Your circumstances will change. All of a sudden new expenses come up, or you lose the money, or whatever else happens. But you may not be in a position to hand over your wealth to these people tomorrow. So do it while you can, and do it as much as you can while you can. So one thing that might happen. The other thing is you might not find the people themselves, right? Who knows that you're gonna, who knows what's gonna happen tomorrow? Whether you're gonna find the person tomorrow to be able to carry the stuff for you all the way to the Day of Judgment. Then he says, another way to lighten your load so that on the Day of so that the path through this world is easier, and then you get the benefits still on the Day of Judgment. The first one was to give charity. Right, free gifts to people with no expectation in return. The second way is, he says, and take advantage of the one who seeks a loan from you while you have plenty, because he will repay the debt to you on the day of your hardship. Right? So the second way to lighten your load is not necessarily to give it for free, but rather give loans. Right? So take advantage of people who ask you for loans and say, please help me out, I need a loan to start a business, I need a loan to pay off my bills or whatever else. That's great. You have the excess money, they need it, take advantage of it. Right? Load them up with whatever you have, and they'll pay it back. Either they'll pay it back now, which is great, then you can use it and maybe loan someone else the money, or you can use it for your own expenses later on when you do need it. That's fine. Even if they don't, right? If they default on their loan and they're not able to pay you back in the world, they will pay you back on the Day of Judgment. Not the money, but the reward of that loan will be there for you. And that's when you need it. That's the day of hardship. Right, so that's when you need them to repay the loan. Not now. Right now you have plenty. A little loan gone here or there, defaulted here or there, isn't going to hurt you very much. But on that day, when you're totally bankrupt, that's when you'll need the loan back, and that's when they'll pay it back to you. Then he says, also know that before you lies a treacherous pass. Right, pass here is like a mountain pass, and Aqaba is a narrow mountain pass. Right, so it's like a tunnel between two mountains, a place that it's the only place to pass by, and you have to go through this because everywhere else there's mountains. Right, so there's no other choice. You have to go through this, but the path itself is very difficult. Right, so here this is a symbol for death itself. So before us lies this treacherous pass, and that pass is death. Right, so it's a narrow pass that all of us have to pass through. On this side there's a plain which is life. On that side there's a plain which is the judgment. But we all have to go through this one path which is very, very hard. Then he says, he who passes slowly across it is worse off than he who passes swiftly. Right? Why do you pass slowly across it? One of the reasons is that our attachments sometimes to the dunya are too great. Right? The process of death is a process of a separation of the soul from the body. Right? That separation from the soul from the body is a separation of the spiritual from the physical. Now if our soul is attached to the dunya, right, we have attachments to property, we have attachments to even people, right? Any sorts of attachments that we might have, those are things that are going to make it harder for the angels to remove our soul from our body. Right? So the more attachments, the harder death is, the longer it takes you to cross over this path, and the more painful, the harder the whole situation is. But if you don't have those attachments, if you're ready for death, and you're ready to drop everything and move on, at the call of Azrael, then death is going to be easy as well, right? So someone who takes a long time to cross over this pass by maintaining these attachments and kind of being grounded in the temporal world, then he's going to have a hard time crossing over, and it's going to be a painful death. But if you lighten your burden, if you don't have as much to carry, then it'll be easy to cross over quickly. Then he says, and know that you must necessarily alight from it either into a garden or a fire. Okay, so we're on this journey, we've passed through the journey, we've been able to hand over our luggage to somebody else to carry it and meet us at the destination, but we still have to pass through. If we have successfully emptied our burden onto these other people and they're going to deliver it, then our passage through life itself on the journey, and also our passage through the pass, which is death, is easy for us. If not, then it's going to be a hard passage, right? But in any case, once we get to this mountain pass, we have to come down from the mountain into the other plane, which is the afterlife, right? He says, when you come down from the mountain pass, when you pass through death, there are only two places that you have as choices for where to end up. You're either going to end up in a garden, which is paradise, or in fire. So, he says, stock it with provisions before you arrive, and ready your destination before you alight. Right? The situation, where we end up, whether it's in the garden or in the fire, and how well stocked the paradise is up to us. Right? We're not like regular guests over there, where we simply go empty-handed and we see whatever the host has ready for us, and we take whatever he has and don't have whatever he doesn't have. That's not the case. It's in our own hands. Right? We ourselves can stock up our paradise however we want it to be. Right? The way you stock it up is by choosing the right actions during the lifetime, where you have a choice in what you do. Right? And so the more good deeds, the more charity you give, the more good that you do here, the more stocked up your paradise will be on that side. Right? So it's completely in our hands how good our paradise is for us. So he says, stock it up with provisions before you arrive. Right? Again, by lessening your burden and handing it over to other people, they'll deliver it to you on that side, and you'll have a fully furnished, a fully furnished paradise on that side. And ready your destination before you alight. For after death, there is no second chance. Right? There's no musta'atab. Isti'atab, and it's used in the Quran as well. It's the ability to be able to return, to have a second chance. Right? وَمَا هُم مِنَ الْمُسْتَعْتَبِينَ. Right? Certain people, nobody is able to be returned to this life and have a second chance at life, to be reborn or that sort of thing. Once you're dead, it's over. So whatever you've earned in this life, however much you stocked up your paradise here, that's all that's going to happen. Once life is over, you can't return and have a second chance to live and maybe earn some more and stock it up some more. That's not possible. So he says, after death, there is no second chance, no way to return to this world. Right, so with a very beautiful image, he set up this whole situation of life and how we're travelers through life, and we want to make sure that we have a light load to go down the path, so we get people to help us to carry what we have. And then we end up at a mountain pass, which is death, and if we are have packed lightly, right, and distributed our belongings to other people, then the passage will be very easy, death will be easy, and then when we alight on the other side, all those things that we gave to other people will be there waiting for us on that side in our fully furnished paradise. Right? So a very beautiful image to help us to keep life itself in perspective, and our money relations in particular. So we want to work hard on one hand, but on the other hand, once we earn, then we have one of two options: either to spend it on ourselves and on the things that we and our families need, or to spend it on charity for other people. And it's only if we do one of those two things that money has any benefit for us. If we don't, it's a waste. We're simply storing up all this money and protecting it for somebody else. Because as soon as we die, it'll all pass on to our heirs. All right, inshallah, we'll continue with this hadith in the next session. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
لا تراه العيون بمشاهدة العيان ولكن تدركه القلوب بحقائق الإيمان معروف بالدلالة.